Hello, welcome to our studio. This is the last post we're going to do with Brooke before the new year. And today we're going to talk about water-soluble oils. So Brooke's never used the oils before, and we're going to do a demo for that. And Marley came in here. She wanted to be on TV, but now you can get down, right? There you go. Okay. So I paint in water-soluble oils. And I used to work in traditional oils, but the problem I had with the oils was you would need turpentine or terpenoid, some sort of solvent, and it's really, really bad for you. And he, Cameron, who's our cameraman here, had asthma, and so I couldn't paint inside the house. So I actually painted in watercolor for a number of years, and then these water-soluble oils came out, and I started painting with them. And I just think they're the greatest thing since sliced bread. So I don't know the specific science of how they work, but I know that basically, you know, oil and water don't mix, but they're able to get oil molecule, water molecules in between the oil molecules so that you can wash your brushes with soap and water. So they're not water soluble like watercolors or acrylics where they're meant to be thinned with water, mm-hmm. but the big thing is you don't need the turpentine or any other solvent to clean them. And then the way they dry is eventually the water evaporates out of them, and then they oxidize like traditional oils. So when the painting is finished, you're just left basically with traditional oils. So there are a number of different brands. I'm just gonna reach over here and grab a bunch of them. Cameron, maybe you can come in here with the GoPro and zoom in on some of these. So there are Winsor & Newton makes them, Holbein makes them, they're the Duo or Aqua Oil. Georgian actually just came out with a new line of water-soluble oils, and Grumbacher. And I use all of the oils, all the different makes. It's just like anything else, there's certain colors that I really like, and I will go to like the Holbein in particular, make some colors that are really, really neat that no one else makes. They're also more expensive. But then I'll go to, typically for the basic colors, I'll use the Artisan because they're probably the least expensive, and I like it when they come in these great big tubes. So those are the paints. So let's talk, yeah, so we'll talk first about the equipment and the products that we use. So I use a variety of the water-soluble oils from a variety of different brands, and there are some mediums we use as well. So this one here, and this is probably my favorite one. This is made by Holbein. That's their oil painting medium, or they also make a linseed oil. But all of these are also water soluble. So this is what we use to thin the paint if you want to paint kind of in a more fluid manner. And I also put that onto my canvas, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then there are a couple different impasto mediums. So this one here is a liquid impasto. It's actually not a water soluble product, but you can also mix these with traditional oils. But I found that because when I mix these in with the oils, they're still water soluble enough I can use my soap and water to clean them. Mm-hmm. But this one is kind of like a clear paste, so it would be like more transparent.
Okay.
And this one is like ground marble dust mixed up with the oil medium, so it's like body filler.
So it's mostly for just texture?
It's when you want to paint really thick, and they also really speed the drying times.
Okay.
Because some of these paints, the reds in particular, are like really, really notorious. If you put a big thick gob of red, of cadmium red or alizarin crimson, it might take 2 months
wow.
to fully oxidize and cure. If I mix it with the traditional, the water-soluble impasto medium that has the marble dust in it, that same stroke will be dry, hard as a rock, in about 2 or 3 days.
Okay.
So if, whether it's you've got a show coming up and you want to get the, you want the pieces ready to go, or certain times maybe you're going to be doing layering things and you want it to dry because it needs to dry before you can mm-hmm. do the next stage. So just mixing a little bit of this in with the paint, even if you're not using it in the thick texture, will make it dry quicker.
Does it affect the appearance of it?
Not really,
okay.
No. And that's what amazes me. Even though this comes out like an opaque white, when you mix it with the color, it doesn't even really lighten it. So again, like anything, you have to kind of try this and figure out for yourself if you like a certain thing or don't like a certain thing. But those are the basic paints and mediums that I use. There are a ton of other different mediums. You can get a quick dry medium like that comes like this. You can get a stand oil medium, which slows down the drying time. You used to be able to get a, and I guess this actually, does a similar thing, a clear paste that was a quick drying medium that you could mix so your colors would be transparent, so you could do glazing. Like when I did portraits, I did a lot of that. But yeah, and so like anything else, you just need to play around with these. When these first came out, I started using them actually before they were on the market. I read an article in, I think it was the Artist magazine, that I think it was Grumbacker that was coming out with these first. And you could order away for a little blister pack about this big, and it just had a cadmium red, ultramarine blue, cadmium yellow, and white. And where you peel the foil off and you got the four little pockets. And so that was the first time I used them. And you can't use them like traditional oils where you thin things down with turpentine. And I just kind of figured out on my own, tried different things. But that very first painting that I did with those, I won the Best in Oils at the Oshawa Art Association show at the gallery in Oshawa, and that's why I was hooked. I thought, Okay, these are pretty good. And then I've just kind of invented the way that I paint with these, because you can't use them the same way as traditional oils, because we don't thin them down with terps like you would. If you can do that, but then what's the point, right? Because then you have all the same odor problems. Mm-hmm. So that's the paints that I use. And this is a Masterson Stay Wet palette. I think you have one of these as well, right?
Yeah, for Christmas last year.
Yeah, so this is basically like a giant Tupperware container. And if you put your paints in here, then it just keeps them wet much longer. They stop drying out when they're in this and covered. So rather than some of these paints might be dry to the touch in a day or two if I left them out, but in here they'll probably keep for a week. Mm-hmm. And I have often several palettes on the go at any given time. So if I have my sky colors mixed here, if I'm working on a big one, as soon as I'm finished working on the sky and say it's time to do the foliage, I'll put this away and I can come back to it 3 days later if I'm doing more work on the sky and those colors are still there, I don't have to remix them. Mm-hmm. Now, what I put them on is just a piece of, so that's where I put my palette. What I'm using is just palette paper. It's almost like a wax paper. And you can actually use wax paper if you want, if you don't want to spend the money on palette paper. The shiny side is the side that we put the paint on. And this is just on a piece of, I think it's called gator board. It's like the plastic cardboard. And I just have these cut to the same size as the sheet. And they can just go in the Stay Wet palette. And I need some paper towels to clean my hand. Yeah, here we go. That's the other thing about these. You can see that Brooke and I are wearing our paint-covered clothes. Because unless you're super, super, super neat, you're going to get paint on you. And these paints do not wash off. So if you get this paint on your clothes, it's going to stay. You don't want to wear your good clothes in here when you're working on paintings. And then, for cleaning, let me just reach over here. I have two of these big containers. I only put about 2 inches of hot water in them. One of them is just hot water. The other one I just put like a little bit of dish soap in there. Mm-hmm. And then when you go to clean your brush, you rinse it in the soapy one first, and then you rinse it in the clean one, and then just dry it off. You can use paper towels, or I like to use my shirt to dry off my brushes, which is why they look the way they do. And that's basically all the materials you need. And again, warm water works better than cold water, so I do it every day. I kind of refresh the water every day, or even later in the afternoon if you're doing a lot of switching from one color to another, and I'll put fresh hot water in. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's it in terms of what the materials we use. And now let's get to what we paint on. So I get asked all the time why I paint on a red canvas. And so let's use this opportunity, first of all, to explain that. Now I'm just going to squeeze out some paint here. Squeeze out some magenta. I've described this a lot to people, but I think it's easier to see if you actually see it in person. If I paint on a white canvas, the areas where the canvas is not covered, I get a really white, sparkly effect. And that's actually not a bad thing. It's just I don't want it in my paintings. Whereas if I paint, what do we got back here? So this is just a wooden panel. Actually, green's not a good color to demonstrate this. Let me do some blue. If I paint this on a red panel, we still have that same sort of dry brush thing going on, but because it's a mid value, it's not nearly so distracting.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think it's a good, most artists will tone their canvas a certain color before they start, just because that can be really distracting in a painting, that contrast of the white sparkling through. Now, you could also use that as a technique to paint if you want. Again, nothing that happens on the canvas is good or bad in and of itself. It's whether that is interfering with what you want or whether it's adding to it. So for me, I just like working on the red canvas. That color works best for me. And because I try to paint the sun, that red sparkle really helps. Now, the problem we have with these paintings in general is also kind of showing up here, and that is that it's like going on as like dry brush, right? That's not a really effective kind of way of painting, or it certainly limits a lot of the things that you can do. So for me, this was one of the big discoveries for me that really helped, is using this oil. So what I do on any painting before I start is, and so this is just canvas here that is just taped down on the board. So what I do is put a little bit of the water mixable oil on there, and then using one of these brushes. So this brush is a Sterling Edwards watercolor brush. He's actually a buddy of mine. If you go to just Google Sterling Edwards and go to his website, you can buy these online. These are the best brushes for doing this, because you need a really wide brush that's got stiff, short bristles. Otherwise, you're going to end up soaking a lot of that oil into the brush. And if you use a regular brush, you'll destroy it. Whereas this thing, I've been using for probably 10 years doing this. And so you want to spread the oil around so that it's just kind of a little bit of a shine on the canvas. I just don't want it. I've got that circle there for a reason. We're going to do a little color theory as well. Okay, so if I'm doing a big painting, like a 4x7, it's 20 minutes of elbow grease with it on the floor and spreading all this stuff out. And the way you tell that it's right is when you're finished, if you hold the painting up, first of all, if you look to the light, you can see where it's shiny, but you don't want it enough if there's any drips. If there's any drips coming down, it's too much, so then you can either use a paper towel or a rag to wipe some off and spread it out, but you want that thin, just a real glistening coat. And then when that's on there, now hopefully this will show really well here as well. You see how it kind of fills in those gaps? Here we have all of this dry brush, and there, even though it's like a dry brush, even though I actually have this like a dry brush amount of paint in there, the oil fills in the gaps as it kind of bleeds in there. So this would be good if you're doing like wash type stuff and you're just blocking in your shapes, then that's much easier than doing this. When I first started using those brushes, I was just painting on the dry canvas, and I actually used to break brushes trying to scrub it into the tooth of the canvas where it's really dry. If you're spreading paint around a big area, then that can be really difficult.
So do you usually put the oil on and then tone your canvas afterwards?
No, so I tone my canvas first. That's actually a really good point. I'm glad you're here. So this is fluid acrylic. I use Golden. They're probably one of the best brands. And so I tone my canvases to get them red with the fluid acrylic. And I'll just squeeze it out on the canvas and then use a big brush, not that stiff bristle brush, but a bigger brush with kind of longer bristles to coat the canvas. That also seals the canvas a little bit, which makes the paint slide on even a little more. But yeah, tone that color first. And then what I actually do too, I do my underpainting in acrylic, but just basically it's a silhouette of kind of like the tree shapes or whatever I'm doing. I just block in my basic composition, usually using blacks or purples, purples for kind of a mid-tone dark, and then blacks for where I want it really dark.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I've blocked in the composition, then I put the oil on, and then I start working immediately with the oils. And then you can paint oils over acrylic, but you can't paint acrylics over oils because the oil will repel the water-based paint. So that type of thing too. So when I used to do portraits, I would actually do an underpainting in the portrait, like just using burnt sienna and painting almost like watercolor to block in that the actual face. Because the neat thing about it is, so with acrylic, like once it's dry, it's there. So once you've got your underpainting, if it's a really complex subject matter, once you've got your underpainting done in acrylic, just block, like almost like a drawing, but in paint, then when you're painting over top, if you know, have you ever painted a portrait and the corner of the mouth starts moving and all of a sudden you've lost it and it's like, oh, I had it, but it's gone.
Yeah.
If the whole painting is just in oil and it's wet, it's gone. Whereas if you've nailed that underpainting, then you can just take a Q-tip, wipe off the paint. Oh, okay, there's where it's supposed to be. And you don't have to keep redrawing stuff. Once you've got the drawing accurate, then it's there. You could also, if you were working on white canvas, you could do the same thing with a drawing in charcoal or something, but then you'd have to fix it. And I just find it's easier doing it in acrylic paint and then coming over top. But when I do an underpainting, it's just monochromatic. It's just to block in the drawing aspect of it. Okay, so the next thing I want to talk about is actually preparing your palette. So we've got the palette paper, and make sure it's the shiny side up. You'll know if it's not because your paints will start drying out because it will suck all the oil. The other side's kind of porous. So I occasionally put it down the wrong way and I can immediately tell because and the oil actually goes into the paper, and so you see like a big wet area around where it's sucking it in.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a typical palette of mine of a painting that I was working on. And you can see what I do is mix all of my colors on my palette, at least getting them close to the colors that I want. And you do that using a knife. You can just use your brush to mix them, but the problem is the brush soaks up a lot of paint and it contaminates all the other paint. So you'll go through an awful lot more paint and end up rinsing a lot more out and throwing a lot out and needing to squeeze more on there if you do your mixing with a brush.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm gonna do too here is we're gonna do a little bit on color theory. I don't know how much you know about it, but there's some basics that are really important. And so we're gonna do that. But before I do that, I just want to mix this blue a little bit lighter. Okay. And then we're gonna do some color theory on this canvas here. So let me just grab a brush. Okay, so the basics of color theory are there are three primary colors, red, blue, and yellow. And from those colors, theoretically, we can mix every other color. So, but all blues are not equal, all yellows are not equal, and all reds are not equal. There is only one primary hue of each. And camera, can you just maybe set that over here to get it out of the way? So if you're using a blue, the pure primary blue is a phthalo blue or a cyan blue, or I think Winsor Newton calls them Winsor blues or any other phthalo colors. And so that is in the spectrum, that's exactly in the middle of the blue. And then for the red, what we typically think of as red is actually more an orange. The primary red is a magenta. So it's tending more towards pink or purple than what we normally think of as red. So fire engine red is actually an orangey red. And then for the yellow, it's like a cadmium yellow light is the primary yellow. It shouldn't have any sort of an orangey tint to it. And from those three colors, theoretically, we can mix any other color. But we actually can't, because what happens whenever you mix any two colors, you lose a little bit of the intensity. So now I'm gonna do what I said not to do. I'm gonna use my brush to mix these. But if I take the red and the yellow, then we get kind of an orangey color. And as I mix more of the red into that, this is what people often think of as a red, that kind of fire engine red. And it gets really important when we get up to the purples in terms of why we need that red. And then we'll do the same with mixing a little more yellow into the mix. Coming down here, and then this is what people think of as yellow too, which is more like a cadmium yellow deep or a cadmium yellow medium. And let's just kind of mix that around. And then obviously the same with the blue and the yellow to mix a green. It's more in the bluey greens. And you can see that each of those colors that I'm mixing, not quite as bright or intense as the pure color, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's why people ask me why I use so many colors on my palette. You can see I actually left a little bit of water in my brush so it starts taking the paint away. Nice. So you don't want that to happen.
So you never mix the colors on your canvas, you usually do it ahead of time?
Well, you could do the blending here, but if I was doing, and I'm just doing this for the purpose of actually showing that I'm using the three primaries, mm-hmm. if I was painting these colors, I would be doing all of this on my palette.
Oh, okay.
And so then I've got all of these colors to choose from.
Oh, I see.
But it just, I find it, well, I got some red in there. Okay. So now when we go to do the purples, I think cause probably the most trouble of anything for people when they're trying to mix them. And I can explain in a second why people have so much trouble with purples. And you need to know color theory to know that. So you can see that red and that and the phthalo blue. So a magenta and the phthalo blue actually go quite nice together to give us a really nice purple. Mm-hmm. But it's because we're using the pure blue and the pure red. What often happens, so I've got a cadmium red here on the palette as well. So this is what people often think of as red. Mm-hmm. And you can see that's a little more in the orangey than that. Mm-hmm. And if I mix that with blue, I get kind of a brownish purple,
yeah,
as opposed to a really pure violet. And I'm going to explain exactly why that happens. So this is a much nicer purple than that.
Yeah.
You cannot get this purple using this red.
Yeah.
So now that we've got our colors there, let's look at some of the terminology. So we have our three primaries. We have our red, our yellow, and our blue. And then on the color wheel, what you'll see, if this is a perfectly done color wheel, they should be equally spaced, and then the colors in between them, the green, orange, and purple, are secondary colors. These relationships of where things are in a color wheel is really, really important because of something called complementary colors. So the complements are a color exactly opposite a color on the wheel. So yellow and purple, for example, are complements. And the reason that complementary relationship is so important is because of the way they behave with each other. So if we take a purple and we mix it with its complement, it will give us a neutral or a gray. So if you take a purple and you mix it with a yellow, if it's a absolutely pure complement, so this purple's a little probably on the red side, which is why it's going more brown. But all of your complements, when you mix them together, they go into a neutral. And if they're absolutely perfect complements, it'll go to a neutral gray, a pure gray. But we really don't want that often. We want more kind of color in our complements. Mm-hmm. So whenever you want to mix a kind of a neutral or a grayish color or brown color, if you mix complements, you'll do that. Also, if you have a really bright, intense yellow, and you think, wow, that's just a little bit too bright, if I mix a little bit of purple into that, that'll dull down yellow. Mm-hmm. Same thing for orange and blue, same thing for red and green. So you can use them to dull down each other. You can use them to make neutral colors. And it doesn't stop there. If I do two strokes of yellow just on the white paper, when you put a complement next, one complement next to another, it brings out a greater intensity in both of them. So if I surround this yellow with a purple, this yellow appears brighter than this one, mm-hmm. even though it's exactly the same color. Mm-hmm. So that's an amazing relationship that we can use these to dull each other down by mixing them together, or we can use them to bring out a greater intensity by putting them beside each other in their pure form.
Yeah.
And so that's it for color theory in terms of how it works. The color wheel is really, really important. And if you have trouble remembering it, you can buy these where it's kind of perfectly gradated to see what they are. It becomes second nature. And where this becomes really important is when you think of colors, because knowing this allows you to mix any color. So if for example, we're gonna talk about like a raw sienna, you always think in terms of color. Anything that's not a pure color, it's a grayed down version of something else. Mm-hmm. So like a raw sienna, which is like a dirty yellow, you just know that that's like a yellow that's been kind of dirty down. So there's like a raw sienna, right? A burnt sienna has a little more red in it.
Yeah.
So if we just add a little more red, so now it's kind of an orange, that's more like a burnt sienna. But if we go, well, that's too bright, we want to dull it down. So again, you need to think of this not as a brown, but as an orange. So what's the complement of the orange is the blue. So if I add a little blue to this, then I can darken that burnt sienna and make it even more gray.
Yeah.
And so again, let's do that with a, let's do it with a, with more of a reddish kind of brown. Okay, now so that's even more red, but I want to dull that down. Mm-hmm. So the complement of red is green.
Mm-hmm.
So if I take a little bit of yellow and a little bit of blue, get a green, and I mix that in there. Now I'll dull down that reddish brown. And the beauty of this is, so I don't use any browns in my paintings. I shouldn't say that. Occasionally, if I have something that's like a ton of the painting is going to be in these kind of tones, I might put some burnt sienna on there, but I'll mix it with all these colors.
Mm-hmm.
But the beauty of this is all of these colors have a lot of variety in them, and it moves along the spectrum from more yellow to more orange to more greenish. So this one here actually is a greenish brown,
mm-hmm.
which can be really, really effective. And if you mix all of your browns, then your painting is just more colorful, because there's nothing worse than someone be able to look on the canvas and go, oh, I see you've used Winsor Newton's burnt sienna.
Yeah.
And that's the problem when people mix brown, or when people use browns, they tend to use them out of the tube.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if you mix all your browns, and if you know color theory, then it just becomes like automatic. You don't have to think about it. I didn't know this when I left the police force,
mm-hmm.
to paint full time. So it took a while. I used to have to think, and especially when I painted in watercolor, because this is in watercolor mud. Whenever you get two complements together, you get mud.
Mm-hmm.
This is also really important when you're doing a painting with a lot of greens in it. If you have a lot of green in the painting, then by mixing yellows, blues, and reds and oranges in with those greens, you get the same sort of color variety going on,
mm-hmm.
which is, again, I don't like painting in the summer typically anyways, just because it's too green. But if you're gonna have a lot of greens, then you want a lot of subtle variations in there. And I'm also just gonna show you why I use a lot of colors too. Let me go. So while theoretically we can mix every color, again, the fact that anytime we mix two colors together, we lose a little bit of the brightness and intensity means that no matter how much I mix that phthalo blue, even if I just mix it with white, that's a turquoise kind of out of the tube. I can't mix that. I can mix something that approaches that color and that value, but it won't be as bright or intense or have as much saturation. And the same with, just get in here. This one, need to get an orange. So here's a color here from Holbein. It's called Luminous Orange. So this is like going way over the top.
Whoa, that's great. Yeah.
So it's almost neon. So it's like, you know, there's no way I can mix that color using the red and the yellow.
Yeah.
And if you look at this, it's like, there's no way I would ever want that color in my painting. But if I mix this with my cadmium yellow light, that gives me a yellowy orange that is much more intense than I can mix there. If I mix that with my cadmium red, same thing, it gives me a reddish orange that's just a little more intense than it would be. So these luminous colors in Holbein, they come luminous yellow, luminous red, luminous, there's a luminous green, there's a luminous violet. It allows you to get very pure versions of those secondary and tertiary colors. And again, often you wouldn't use it by itself just because it's so bright and intense, or at least I wouldn't, even though I like bright, intense color. Mm-hmm. But when I mix that with a regular version of that color, if I mix that luminous orange with a cadmium orange, then again, it gives me a cadmium orange that's just a little bit brighter than an actual cadmium orange. And sometimes I want that. So again, that bright, bright, intense orange really has no business in a painting. But this bright, intense reddish orange does. And I can't get that, well, I certainly can't mix that using just red, yellow, and blue.
Yeah.
And I don't even think I can get it out of the tube with a cadmium red light. It's just a little bit, got a little bit more punch.
Yeah.
So that's why when I set up my palette, I actually set my palette up like the color wheel, starting with yellows here and ending with greens here. But I might have 22 colors there, but because I have pure intense versions of cadmium yellow light, cadmium yellow medium, cadmium yellow deep, cadmium orange, cadmium red light, red medium, red deep, magenta, alizarin crimson, because I know I can't mix any version of those as pure as it comes out of the tube.
Mm-hmm.
But that also becomes much more complicated because you have so many more colors on your palette. You can end up with it all looking like that really quickly.
Yeah.
If you don't know what you're doing. Okay, so we've talked about color theory, about the paint, but we haven't really talked about brushes in terms of what kind of brushes we use. And this is one of those things where it works out really good for the artist. I used to paint in watercolor, so a red sable brush might cost you $100 for one that's that thick. The brushes that I like using best are just hog's hair brushes. Mm-hmm. I get mine, for those of you up in the Toronto or Canada area, Curry's, and these are just the Curry's make a brush. They're the cheapest brushes they make.
Okay.
and they're the ones I like. I actually had, you can get really expensive ones of these. I had a set of Escoda brushes that were probably 5 times as much or 10 times as much as these. I like the Curry's ones best.
Mm-hmm.
And I have about 8 of these buckets of brushes lying around. Some of these you might think are garbage, because some of these are the ones that I use for acrylic to block in my paintings.
Yeah.
And every brush is just a tool to make a mark. So you will have, so for this, these, I think these brushes here are similar. I think these are almost the same brush. Same size, same, I think they're both just flats or filberts, but this one's worn down almost to a nub, and this one is fresh. This brush here is actually more valuable than this one in terms of what it can do. And if I'm just gonna do a brief thing on why I keep all my brushes and what those brushes that look like garbage are really good for and can be much more useful for. So if I wanted to paint a branch, and so let's just mix up kind of a dark kind of brownish color. Okay, if I want to paint a branch on a tree, it's supposed to go from thick, oh, we're actually in the where there's no oil on it. Okay, it should go from thick to thin. But that's really difficult to do with a bristle, with a brush that has long bristles and where they're fairly soft. And this is what I see in a lot of beginner paintings, where the brush goes from thick to thin to thicker to thinner to thicker. And trees don't do that. Trees go from thick to thin, branches go from thick to thin. And to try and paint a really thin branch with any of those types of brushes is almost impossible. If I take this one here that's worn down to a nub, this now acts like a pencil for me.
Mm-hmm.
And if I press hard, it gives me a thick line as I lighten up on the pressure. The branch gets lighter and kind of disappears. Also, if I go fast, it goes from thick to thin. So this is a really effective tool for doing branch-like shapes. Much better than the one with the thick bristles.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm doing a big tree or a big branch, then I'll use one of these big brushes that has, it is almost rock hard, but I use this, it's almost like I'm using it like a piece of charcoal, because I can draw with it and be very, very accurate about thinning, going from thick to thin. Same thing by lightening up. Now, if you make a mistake, this is a Q-tip. This is one of the biggest discoveries
tool.
I made. Especially when you think about the fact that these are water-soluble oils. So if I do something, let's say I start here and I go, oh, I don't like that shape. And I want that back the way it was. What you don't want to do with oils, in acrylic, you could just wait for that to dry, repaint that color over top, mm-hmm. and you're back to square one. If we try to do that here, we end up getting this and getting mud everywhere. And the more you build up, you tend to want to go from thinner applications of paint to thicker. So the more you build up paint, the more difficult it is to make any sort of corrections or even add paint. You get so much paint on there. Then it's like, you know, if you've ever iced a cake, at a certain point, you're taking more icing off than you're putting on. And
mm-hmm.
so it's the same sort of thing. Whereas with the Q-tips, so I put it in my mouth, which makes sense because this is water soluble, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I will take, it might take me 3 or 4 Q-tips of doing that, but I can then get back to almost the white of the canvas. Or let's say I don't paint on the white canvas, back to the red of the canvas.
Yeah.
And that is really, really good for making tiny adjustments. In particular for me, where I paint, so let's do this, even though we're on the white of the canvas. If I paint my branches first, and then I paint my sky holes around them, I do negative shape painting around them, but occasionally I paint over top of a branch
mm-hmm.
with the sky. So again, I could try to come back in here just with dark paint, but again, I'm going to get into a mess. So what I do is I use the Q-tip to remove that. And because I've done my underpainting in acrylic, that will just get me back to the black of the branch. But
yeah.
even if you're painting kind of the whole thing in oils, you've now removed all that excess paint and can come back in and refine that. So using a Q-tip to refine an edge and then going back and painting up to it is much better than trying to just go over top of it with more paint of the same color, because you'll just end up with a big mess of paint
yeah.
on your canvas where you have no control over it.
Yeah. So
that's it in terms of brushes. I use mainly the hog's hair. There are also brushes that are made for the water soluble paints that have it's almost like a fish in line monofilament acrylic bristle. Those are good too for, I use those sometimes for small detail areas. And then I also have, what we got here? You can get little, what is this made by? It's a factory second. Yeah, cheaper. I don't spend a lot of money on brushes for this, but it might take me, if I'm painting leaf shapes, like foliage shapes, I might actually have to, so that brush does not a bad leaf shape, but every different brush here will give me a different type of stroke.
Mm-hmm.
And even this same brush at I will have this brush, this size, and it's a filbert. I'll have it like in 8 variations from being right out of the package to worn down to a nub. Each of those will give me a slightly different type of mark. And so that's what I find is the key for me when I'm painting, is not trying to take one brush and make it do all these jobs. It's find the right brush that makes the right mark. And again, sometimes I literally, so this is like, what is this, a number 4 flat. If I'm, in particular when I'm painting like little areas like the sky holes, I might go through 4 different brushes in the first 5 minutes to try to find the one that's an exact right amount of worn down to give me the type of shapes and enough control that I want. And typically the more wore down the brush is, the more control you have and the more it's like drawing.
Mm-hmm.
The longer the bristles, the harder it is to control because it flops around.
Mm-hmm.
So again, having brushes in a variety of different states of wear just gives you many more options in terms of the types of strokes you make. So that's it about brushes. I wouldn't spend a lot of money on brushes for painting with the water-soluble oils. Unless if you're doing portraits, then at a certain point you might actually want to use like a sable brush when you're getting into the eyes or something like that. But for me, I use the cheapest brushes I can get. Not because they're cheapest, actually, but because they're the ones I like the most.
Yeah.
So how often does that turn out?
Yeah, well that works.
And oh, you'll also get people telling you, I'm committing a horrible sacrilege here. I'm washing my hog bristle brushes in water. And now you're not supposed to do that because it makes the bristles expand and it's bad for the brushes. And this is a tool to do that.
Mm-hmm.
And actually the fact that when these wear down, that changes the shape and allows me to get different things. So don't get too caught up in your materials. If this was a watercolor brush, then yes, because again, you want to keep a watercolor brush forever if it's a $100 brush.
Yeah.
This is a $4 brush. I don't care what happens to this brush, whether I destroy it in one painting, or again, as I said, even when it gets worn down, or if it kind of plumps up, that just allows me to make a different kind of mark.
Mm-hmm.
So don't send me comments that you shouldn't clean hog bristle brushes because you'll ruin them. It's like, yes, we will ruin them, and that's why I have so many of them here, and they are cheap. Okay. So what I want you to do, and I'm going to give you I have a bunch of raw canvas, not rods, it's primed with gesso, but it's just on a roll, so that you can kind of play around with these paints before you actually start doing the paintings. And even your first few paintings, you might want to do that because you don't want to burn through a lot of expensive stretch canvases.
Yeah.
What I'd like you to do is do a couple paintings, whatever subject matter you like. But I want you to use cadmium yellow light, magenta, phthalo blue, and then black and white.
Okay.
And I want you to, I want you to do some colorful paintings too. Like don't pick some. Actually, I shouldn't just. And I'd also like you to do one that's kind of more in the neutrals.
Okay.
So that, because the best way to learn about color is by painting with a really limited palette, just the 3 primaries, black and white, because that teaches. If you want a mix of a burnt sienna color, you have to figure out how to do it.
Yeah.
And then what happens is it becomes second nature. Even though I might have 15 colors on my palette, if I want to mix a violet that's just slightly more red than blue, you know, I know how to do that. And it's like, oh, if it's too bright, I need to darken it down, or I need to lighten it up, I know what to do. Just it becomes instinctive. But if you start out with all kinds of colors on your palette, you never really kind of learn that, so that it just becomes like 2 + 2 = 4.
Yeah.
So that's what I'd like you to do. And typically when we're working with the oils, you want to go from thinner applications to thick. So for example, when you're painting in dark shadowy areas, that's when you want kind of thin paint where, again, you're almost kind of scrubbing it into the canvas. Because again, the more paint we get on there, the more difficult it gets to control. But then if I'm painting like a yellow into or on top of that, I could come in with a thick stroke of yellow over top.
Okay.
But you'll also notice too, that one thing you're going to have to get used to that you don't have to worry about in acrylics is every time you put the brush down, it's like forensics. You're not just putting paint down, you're picking stuff up. So while I had almost a pure yellow in there, because I touched the wet blue, now I've got a greenish yellow in my brush. So if you, for example, you want to do 4 or 5 strokes of intense yellow over top of the blue, you need to clean the brush between each stroke and put more paint on there because it's picking up that. And so that you'll find tricky. But it's also really cool because if you want to do a gradation, from, let me get some, like a yellowish green. So if I want a bright yellow green here and I want it to be less there, I know just because it's gonna keep picking stuff up, now I've got that gradation in the intensity of the yellow and the contrast between there just because it's picking up. And there are times when that is useful rather than having to mix all of those each time.
Yeah.
But it's just getting used to that, knowing that when you're, and if you're painting into a complement, it's gonna neutralize it. It's not such a big deal if you're painting into a analogous color, which is close to it on the color wheel. So if I'm painting that yellow into kind of the orange and the red, you see it's not really changing until we get up to the purple. And then it starts really neutralizing that yellow and taking it down. So if you're painting a complement one into another, it's really going to neutralize the paint that's in your brush. If you're painting it on a color that's close to it in the color wheel, it's not going to have as much of an effect.
Okay.
And I think that's enough to keep you busy.
Yes, I think so.
Okay. So that's it. So next time, I guess when we get together, we'll see your kind of your deep, and we'll find out your debriefing to how these work. Because for me, it's kind of funny because I've been using these now for 20 years. It's like second nature, but when people try them, I know.
This is my first time ever using oils.
And I know a lot of oils in particular, just in general, can be tricky. These water soluble oils, because of the fact that we're not using turpentine, and I know a lot of people have tried them on dry canvas and done this and said, well, I don't want to paint oils in dry brush. And then they just kind of throw. I've talked to so many people who have these sitting in drawers that they tried them once and then just gave up in frustration. Mm-hmm. So that big key is putting the oil down first. And then for me, working on a toned canvas. Mm-hmm. Although you don't have to. I mean, again, I actually like, even if you're painting on a white canvas here, like there's something really neat about these have a real glow to them that maybe acrylics don't have. And plus the ability that they're mixable for at least a day. So the ability to blend softly and that kind of thing. So we will see you all next time. And then we can find out how Brooke found these and see what she's done. So take care. I'm Tim Packer.
And I'm Brooke Cormier.
And you can also follow Brooke on, we'll link it up on our post. You can follow you on Instagram and Facebook.
Yeah.
Okay, and Brooke's been doing some time lapses of her stuff on there too, so you might want to check that out. Okay.